first Sunday in Lent. And I'm so happy to see all of you in our sanctuary and also those who are joining with us via Zoom as we prepare our spiritual journey, especially for this Lent period. I would like to just remind you again some of the spiritual discipline that has been widely and commonly practiced in our Christian tradition is prayer and fasting, act of mercy, and also meditating on God's word, and also abstinence of some form that will nurture us in the practice of penitence. So abstaining from enjoying or consuming your favorite food, if it is a steak, perhaps at least several times, you abstain from those practices. And also, if it is leisure time, watching football is over now, but all other kinds of sports, you can reserve that time to just have that special time in the communion with God. Our God is yearning to bless all of us with hope, courage, and a chance for the renewal of our life. And that is available when we gather together as an assembly of God's people. As I'll be talking about some of my personal experience for today's sermon, this is the time that we are formed. That God not only gave us this wonderful sacred space, but also a sanctuary in our heart that we can meet God and hear God's voice and feel God's presence deeply in our heart as well as in this sacred time and space. So brothers and sisters, let us prepare our hearts and approach to the throne of God's grace. Let us worship God.
Call to worship. Out of death have I called to thee, O Lord. Lord, hear my cry.
I wait for the Lord with all my soul. I hope for the fulfillment of his word.
For in the Lord is love unfailing, and great is his power to set people free.
I wait for the Lord with all my soul. I hope for the fulfillment of his word.
Oh, my God. morning. Good morning, good morning, good morning. I'm going to sit right here in the middle. Sort of a middle. It's an uneven number, so we can't have an exact middle. Couple of things. I need to let you know the results of the Super Bowl of Caring offering. I want to be sure that you've heard that the Chiefs won the game and the total in the first service. The Eagles in the second service took it over by $65. So that our grand total, and as I've said many times, for the real winner of the Super Bowl, the Norwood Food Pantry, was, listen to this, $405.
Oh, yeah.
Congratulations, everybody. I think, and that's one Sunday, we're going to turn our attention now to other offerings that need to be made for all kinds of struggles that are going on in the world right now. One will be, you're going to be getting your banks. I think maybe you've had these in the past.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, so you'll fold these into a bank. You'll get these today. I'm so glad. You can show me in Sunday school, okay? I will need a tutorial. But you'll have those, and those will be collected. The offering will be made on April 9th. So if families can just kind of help people, the children and youth, keep their attention turned toward that, it would be very, very helpful. All right. I have two books here with me today. This is one of my favorite books. Christie is the name of it. You ever read that book? Okay, this book is a story. I'll let you see it in Sunday school. Okay, let me see it. I need it so I'll know what to read. Okay, thank you. All right, I'm glad you're interested. Hey, this story is about a young woman who was 19. How old are you now? 12. I mean, like, not much older than you, who went as a missionary deep, deep, deep into the mountains of Tennessee. And guess what? Just 30 miles from where I grew up. So one day, my kids and I, my mom, dad, and my sister, we went to where she was a teacher. She went as a teacher into the mountains. She went as a missionary because she wanted mostly to share the Word of God in her teaching. Now, the place that she went may be hard for you all to imagine. Imagine a place with no electricity, with no plumbing. There were no bathrooms inside. Just a place to go, bathroom outside. Not really a place to go. Well, not, you know, taking a shower, a bath was kind of hard. And so she was kind of a fancy girl. She was from a city, and she went there, and she started realizing that she felt like she was doing a good thing, but the people sort of started irritating her. And they didn't always smell good and fresh. And the worst of all, remember those goats we talked about a few Sundays back? How the sheep listened and followed God's instructions. The goats did not. A lot of these people were kind of like those goats. She wanted to teach them. She wanted to share the Word of God, but they kind of were suspicious. And they kind of thought, I'm not sure I want you around here. Maybe somebody can go listen to you, but I'm not going to. So she was struggling with how she felt about some of the people. And then this happened. She was teaching several kids, students, in a one-room school. They had a window. One day, she was looking out the window and she saw a most beautiful cardinal. And guess what I saw this morning when I got to the church, right in a bush back there? I saw a beautiful cardinal. And she said, isn't it wonderful that God made such a different variety of birds? He must have cared about them or he wouldn't have made them so beautiful. Then she says, she couldn't help but add, he loves everything he's ever made. Every bird, every animal, every flower, every man and woman, every single one of you loves you extra specially. So she said that, they get on with their studies, and then this one little boy named Burl, he's daydreaming, looking out the window. And she says, oh, okay, Burl, what are you thinking about? And he says, and I'm gonna read the way he would have been talking, because it's a different kind of dialect, Appalachia. I know how to talk Appalachia, but I don't know. Teacher, ain't it true, teacher, that if God loves everybody, then we've got to love everybody too? So what did he just say? He said, doesn't God want us to love everybody? And she realized then that she had felt a privilege to dislike whoever she wanted to dislike. And when she realized that if she shut down her privilege of disliking anyone, she could have greater understanding and growing compassion and more love for everybody. Now, that all sounds real good. And it is real good, but there's something even better. And it's the reason that she had said the first time what she said. So what color are these words? Red. So again, these are the words of Jesus Christ. Luke 6, 27 to 31. But I say to you who hear, love your, think you got the next word? God, self, neighbor, you think you got it? Love your enemies. You knew enemies was coming. Excellent. Do good to those who hate you. Come on now. Bless those who curse you. Pray for those who mistreat you. Whoever hits you on the cheek, offer him the other cheek. Also, that doesn't mean like we're supposed to go hitting our brothers or anything like that. Whoever takes away your coat, do not withhold your shirt. Now, this one is like, is that really in the Bible? Give to everyone who asks of you. Are you? Yeah, it's in there. Look, there it is. Give to everyone who asks of you. And whoever takes away what is yours, do not ask it back. And just, here we go. And just as you want people to treat you, treat them in the same way. There's another way of saying that, last verse. Are you familiar with do unto others as you would have others do unto you? Which is kind of an old-fashioned way of saying it, but have you heard that? Or do the same to others as you would like them to do to you? Do you know what we call that phrase? Do unto others as you would have them do unto you. The golden rule. So, people have made up that name for it, but it is the words of Jesus Christ. So in Sunday school today, we're going to look at the golden rule and see how in the world we can really care about those that irritate us or frustrate us or are actually doing harm to others. We've got to talk about this. So let's pray together. Dear God, you tell us to love everyone. Even our enemies. Sometimes that feels impossible. But you also say, through Christ, all things are possible. So we ask your help and invite you into our hearts. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Okay, wait for me at the back, please. Let's get back to our amoeba status.
Together, prayer for illumination. Lead us in this moment of proclamation, God, and align us with your Spirit. Motivate us with your word. Remind us of your commandments. Challenge us to live in your way. Hold us accountable to do more than sing any prayer. In Christ, amen.
Genesis chapter 28 and verse 15 and 16.
I am with you and will watch over you wherever you go, and I will bring you back to this land. I will not leave you until I have done what I have promised you. When Jacob woke from his sleep, he thought, surely the Lord is in this place, and I was not aware of it. Galatians chapter 2, verse 20 and 21. I have been crucified with Christ, and I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. The life I now live in the body, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. I do not set aside the grace of God, for if righteousness could be gained through the law, Christ died for nothing. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. That must be revered. It may be the sense of saying no for a young toddler to protect already fragile sense of ego. And it must be a scary thing to say no, especially to parents, because the young child still needs the parents' approval as to build up his or her own sense of self-esteem. Honoring this sacred and holy space in us is very important as to express our respect toward others. Spiritually speaking, I call this place a kind of a sacred parking space, uniquely reserved for God's Holy Spirit to dwell in us. This sacred and holy space allows us, our soul, to obtain meaning and purpose in our lives. Sometimes it emerges surprisingly when we search for a meaningful interaction between what we do in our daily life and how our actions participate in building up God's kingdom here on earth. Cultivating this sacred place in our heart reminds us that we not only live for the bread, but also we live something far more meaningful and purposeful. As the Holy Scripture reminds us that one does not live by bread alone, but every word that comes from the mouth of God. Matthew chapter 4, verse 4. Going back to the analogy of parking space, this simply means that God's parking space can only be filled by God's holy presence. And there is nothing else in this world that can replace and satisfy for that deep inner longing. In order to deepen our understandings on this matter, how to cultivate the sacred place in our heart, there are a few things that I would like to invite you to consider. The first is that God reveals God's self to us in a specific place and time in life. You know, God does not come to us in a fantasy island. But often comes to us as we sojourning in the wilderness of life. For example, the very, very first time when God was knocking at the door of my heart was in the hospital room in a small city in Korea called Gumsan. I was desperately pleading for my father's life. When he became coma after having a massive brain hemorrage, I was 17 and I was very aware of the critical condition of my father. A couple of days ago, I pulled out my own diary for 22 days of recording from the day when my father was hospitalized and then miraculously after 3 weeks when he was discharged. Miraculously, after 3 weeks of coma, God healed my father and restored his health so that he was able to continue to serve another 15 years in the United States as a Presbyterian minister. Then God appears to me again in the parking lot of an office building nearby my high school, where I worked as a janitor most of during my high school days. And the building was located in Elizabeth Pike in Falls Church in Fairfax County in Northern Virginia. Whenever I visit my younger brother, sometimes I drive, swing by there, just recalling my experience. Again, it was the very, very cold winter night. When I was overwhelmed with all the burdens and challenges as I faced going through this totally different cultural and life reality as an immigrant boy. My father established a newly developed congregation where you can hardly find any Korean Americans, neither Asian Americans back then in the late 70s. So he had a very small congregation, and of course he was not able to get support from the congregation. So our family was struggled, and I know as a first son, quite a heavy financial responsibility fell upon me. So that's why I got a job as a janitor during my high school day. And in that cold winter night, have you ever imagined after you had 3 inches or 4 inches of snow in a very cold during the afternoon, and when cars were parked and when all the office workers went home and they left distinctive tire marks all over the parking spot. And my job was to carry off about 40 heavy trash bags into the very corner of the parking lot where I can dispense all these garbage bags. And pushing through those about 200 meters was a daunting task. Imagine, slippery, and you can't really push the car because already there is an irregularity formed by the tire tracks. And I felt and I hurt my knees, and in the cold winter night, I felt so miserable. I was ready to give up my life, my hope for the future, and just gazing up in the dark night sky. And I was crying. God, what am I doing? What am I doing? And then God came to me through a remembering a biblical passage that my father used to share with me. And it is from Genesis chapter 28, verse 15. I am with you, Timothy. I will keep you. I will keep you wherever you go. Timothy, don't cry. I will bring you back to this land, and for I will not leave you until I have done everything that I promised you. In the wilderness of life, God spoke to me through God's word. You know, if you read the Bible, all through the history, God met people in a specific place in a very peculiar circumstances. And God had them to remember who God is and have them to go back to that sacred place and to renew their faithfulness, renew their doubt into a full trust, believing in God, in God's goodness. When our faith stands in doubt, then you go back to those places and you remember those places, how God met you and raised you up from that time, that place of despair. And your faith can be validated again, and the temptation torments your soul. And when temptation really torments your soul, then you can always go back and fear God's presence. When the future seems gloomy, uncertain, just like I felt back then, you can go back and open up the windows of hope for tomorrow in Jesus Christ. Friends, do you have such a place? Do you have such a sacred place in your heart that can help you stand before God and experience God's goodness and presence? The second point is that even though God encounters us in a specific place and time in life, God never wants us to get so stuck or attached to that physical place only. Why? Because a church is ultimately not a building, but it's assembly of God's people. You know, in Judaism, the Ark of Tabernacle or Ark of Covenant is the single most important religious object, because the Ark of Covenant contains three most important objects in their faith. One, a golden pot their ancestors used to gather manna in the wilderness. The second object is Aaron's staff as a high priest who led Israel along with Moses. Aaron's staff is kept there, and also two tablets of Ten Commandments. So the Ark of Covenant does represent for Israelite a real presence of God, no matter what situation they're in. And this is why when the Hebrews, when they engage in a battle, they always have Ark of Covenant in the front formation of battle, bearing that Ark of Covenant, trusting that God will fight for us. In 587 BC, when the Temple of Jerusalem was utterly destroyed by the Babylonian militaries, many Israelites, including the king Jerachina of Judah, who lost two eyes as he was captured and went on to exile to Babylon. There were thousands of elite peoples and all kinds of craftsmen and leaders of Israel captured as prisoners of war. And all those people in the foreign land, they all lamented and but nevertheless sing. Can we sing the Lord's song in a strange land? Do you know when these people who are in exile, do you know what they did in order to keep their faith alive, in order to really continue to validate their collective identity as God's chosen people? They gathered together every Sabbath. They gathered together in every Sabbath in person and form a community as an assembly of God, and to acknowledge God's faithfulness in spite of their current harsh reality, to believe and affirm that God's promise never fails. And the word synagogue actually means assembly of God's people. In the New Testament era, when Apostle Paul, when he visited churches that he established, the people in Galatia and the Ephesus and Philippi and the Thessalonica, Christian people, they gather together, not in a sanctuary like this, but they gather together as assembly of people in a riverbank, riverside, and they praise God, and they remember the teachings of Jesus Christ. That is the church. Gathering of God's people is what sustains the God's church. And when they gather and offer praise and worship the living God, they claim that very sacred place and holy place in their lives. And this leads us to the last point we need to consider. The most important worship place, most important sanctuary is in our heart. In the beginning of my sermon, I share with you of some critical moments in my life. They were the time in my life that I truly felt lost and helpless, both in physical and psychological and existential sense, in the wilderness of life. I totally felt left alone, not being able to find any tangible help. Neither could I affirm the value of faith during these relentless struggles in life. I looked in front, there was nobody to help me. I looked left and right, there was no one to assist in any means. Then I looked behind only to see the darkness of empty space. Then I looked below me only to fear the bottomless pit on which I was hanging to survive. When I looked above, I only saw cold, dark, night sky. Then God's word began to echo deeply within my heart. The echoing sound get louder and clearer. I was first crying for my miserable life situation, but then as I hear those words, I began to cry out of joy. Thank you, Lord. You are telling me that my life is not wasted. You are telling me that I will have some opportunity to be who I am as you intended to be, to me to be. Then the journey of discovering the purpose of my life slowly began. A soul-searching process to pick up my shattered pieces of myself. All this struggle against my fear, my anxiety, and the meaning of all this process. Amazing thing was, even after I heard those God's voice, my life didn't change. I still have to go to that place and work in the same thing. My mom was still worrying about how to survive, and my father, only thing he knew was preaching the gospel. He never learned any other skills. But then, my perspective toward life completely changed. And this is perhaps why Apostle Paul says, after he met Jesus Christ, he says, I see new heaven and new earth. I don't think those ancient culture was transformed just like the finger snap because he met Jesus Christ, but his perspective, he began to see life through the eyes of Jesus, just like I think that was my experience. I began to see my miserable life, not through the naked eye of my own ego, but I began to see them through the eyes of Jesus Christ. And I began to find a meaning in my struggle. Why I had to keep on trying. Why I had to keep on studying. So I remember, after coming from cleaning all those 7 floors, I came back at 10:30 at night, and I studied until 1:30 a.m., 2 a.m. every day. I don't think I can repeat that dedication and commitment. But after I heard that voice, that's the power and encouragement that God granted me. I will not leave you alone. I will not leave you until that I have done everything that I promised. Then the journey of discovering the purpose of my life began. Where do you go when you encounter such a moment? When your loved one departs from you in the middle of night, when you got a phone call that your mom is in critical condition because of the brain hemorrhage at 2 a.m. When you receive a doctor's note and medical test result that you and your family are deeply concerned, where do you go when you encounter those existential void? You cannot go back to the physical sanctuary, but you can always go and call upon God when you gather your heart and your longing heart and kneel down and offer God a prayer. There you seek for God's presence. There you may hear God's instruction and encouraging word. There you may feel God's presence. There you may reveal your broken dreams and to heal your wounded heart, whatever that is, even that is from long past, you can heal them with God's grace. In the beginning of my sermon, I mentioned about parking space. And I would like to repeat it again. Do you know that God also has a reserved parking space in your soul? If you ever park at a handicapped parking space without any validation, then you are almost likely to have hefty fine. 200 at least. Sometimes when I came to PCIN, I found somebody has already parked in the pastor's or minister's parking space. And I know in the morning when parents of one academy, they want to drop off their kids, and in the afternoon to pick up their kids, and I see they parked parking space reserved minister. Sometimes they even park handicapped parking space. They park secretary, church secretary, and visitors is little more understanding, right? And sometimes I'm annoyed. And I feel sometimes feel resentment to leave some note. But then I began to try to understand they must have some reason. And I just let it go. Then along those lines, I realized that God must feel terrible toward us. God must feel sad when God wants to visit us and have communion with us in that sacred, divine parking space in our soul reserved for God. Then God finds out that we already filled in that spot with something else. Imagine that our regret, our dismissal, our betrayal repeats again and again whenever God wants to knock at our doors of our heart and have a communion with us, and God finds, oh, whether there is something else to preoccupy. Worries, angers, upset, or just something. Dear friends, during this Lent, let us make inner space available for welcoming God's Holy Spirit in our heart. This is one meaningful way for us to reclaim the presence and the lordship of Jesus Christ in our life, especially during this holy season of Lent. Let us clear up the clutters that occupies in our mind, in our thought, and in our soul. And let us restore and reserve God's only parking space in our heart. Make yourself available for God seeks to having that loving communion and friendship with us all the time. May God bless our Lenten journeys together as we read daily devotional booklet and spend some time in your prayer, either in the morning or in the evening. As we participate in Lenten Bible study and thinking about God's word and encouraging one another, and by rendering the act of kindness and mercy, especially those people who need our encouragement. God bless you all. Amen. Let us join our hymn number 543, Abide With Me. We will sing first verse and third and fourth.
Thank you.
spiritual announcement. I would like to just remind you, when you go to fellowship hall, on top of the grand piano, there is a sign-up sheet for celebrating with our congregation many special occasions in your life journey. So please attend to that and sign up to enrich our fellowship hours. And also, starting from this Wednesday at 8 p.m., for about 6-7 weeks, we'll have a Lenten Bible study via Zoom. On Monday, the link will be sent again, but you will probably also find that from the early this week. So please remember that, you know, having Bible study in Zoom compared to having in person with soup and bread, it's just very easy to forget. So I found compared to in-person Bible study, so please remember and join us. Let's encourage one another and be fed by the bread of life. Any other announcement? Yes.
As Kathy announced last Sunday, we are running special fundraising campaign for the victims of earthquake in Syria and Turkey. We are collecting the donation this Sunday, today, I mean, and next Sunday. So please don't forget to join the campaign. Thank you.
And probably the slide that is appropriate also, we recently received a thank you letter, heartfelt thank you letter from PDA, Presbyterian Disaster Assistance. I think I don't quite remember the amount, but I think we sent 4,700 something. And yeah. So, again.
4,240.
Okay, wow. Okay, $500 discount. Thank you so much for your heartfelt support for this. But again, for people who are devastated in Turkey and Syria, let us just extend one more time this week and next week in order to help them with Christ's love. Joys and concerns. Any joys and concerns? Yes. Mary Lou and Abby, yes.
Our joy is that 1 year ago today, you officiated over Brian and Nancy's wedding. So they are celebrating their 1 year anniversary. They're in Cancun.
Bless their soul. Thank you for sharing. And Abby and Frank.
Today is my mom's birthday, and I just want to thank you, Pastor, and for everyone for keeping her and my dad in your prayers. They live in assisted living now in New Jersey, so this year, for the first time in many years, all five of her children, I'm the oldest, were able to take her out to a diner for dinner.
Oh.
You know, we had and sang happy birthday to her in the town where I grew up in Denver. So that was pretty cool. And so happy birthday to my mom, and thank you, everyone.
And your mom is now almost 90, right?
She's 87 today.
87. Your dad is 90.
He's 91.
91.
Yeah.
When I last time visited them, you know, I was so deeply touched. Because I was sitting there and talking.
Yeah.
And both of them were sitting up from the bed the entire time. They were having.
They never stopped holding hands.
Holding hands?
Holding hands all day long. Yeah.
That must be love.
Yeah, very cute.
It struck me. And he still remembers that. And Frank.
But today in history, back in 1993, people say it was a prelude to 9/11, was the original World Trade Center bombing,
yeah,
where the truck exploded in the basement, killed 6 people and injured 1,000. So prayers go out to those families and also 9/11.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Mm-hmm. Thank you. Any other joys and concern? Yes.
Yeah, the whole family in Woodcliffe Lake recently lost an 18-month-old. They're still not sure why there will be an autopsy, but the family and community are devastated.
No word can replace that. We will keep them in our prayers. Any other joys and concerns? Let us all pray. Holy God, your beauty, your might, your holiness shine forth from morning till evening, and from evening till morning. And the heavens declare your righteousness. We trust that you hold us, all creatures of the world and sea and air, and a whole world in the palm of your loving hand. We trust that we are your children and you are our God. We thank you for the gift of this day, for the gift of life, gift of each other, and gift of loving support. Thank you for faithful friends and families and kind strangers. Thank you for creating us with hearts capable of hope, even when times are very hard. Thank you for your persistent, steadfast, relentless calling, calling us away from stumbling blocks in our path, away from temptation and judgment, envy, isolation, fear, cynicism, despair, away from violence, desire for retribution. Thank you for calling us toward charity, generosity, honesty, forgiveness, community, hope, and trust in you, our faithful God. We thank you for the celebration of life journey. We thank them that you have been so faithful, keeping our moms, our dads into their golden years. We remember the tragic events and plead to you that that would not occur again and again. And we pray for the family and community who lost this young, innocent baby. In the spirit of trust, we call upon you. May your loving, comforting presence fell this morning with everyone, with those who are discouraged by the trials of life, a loss of jobs and meaningful relationships, loss of family members. Embrace with your healing touch all those who struggle with pain and illness of body or mind. Surround with your sustaining presence all who know hunger, homelessness, poverty, or persecution, and all those who feel overwhelmed by addiction, anger, fear, guilt, or doubt. Impress on our innermost soul in our sanctuary your promise that we are not alone, that because you walk beside us, helping to shoulder our burdens, and before us and shining your light on our path, and behind us, protecting us from all dangers we even cannot see. So we lift up to you our enemies, all people who we find particularly difficult to love, and we ask that you meet them in their places of deepest need and heal them where they need healing and surround them with all good things. We pray for peace within our families, within our heart, our communities, our nation, and all along the nations. And we pray for the day when we, with all your beloved children, will live together in peace and unity and in love. Now let us pray as our Lord Jesus Christ has taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Let us bring our offerings in response to God's gracious guidance and blessings. There is no east or west. Jesus Christ, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, both now and forevermore. Amen.
Amen.